Alright, this is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com today with another exciting episode for you. Today I'm in Santa Rosa, California, and I'm at the 8th annual, wow, 8 years already I've been coming to this thing, you believe that? Check the link down below for my videos for the previous years, every year is a little bit different. Anyways, it's the world's pure food fair, the Heirloom Expo here in Santa Rosa, California. You guys missed out, man, it's been a great time. You know, I will say that this year is a little bit smaller than some previous years. You know, in some ways it's not as good, in some ways it's actually better because they actually have different displays that they actually haven't had before. But if you've never been to an Heirloom Expo, you definitely got to come to one of them because you always get the same general feel. It's just a big, almost like a party, right? Almost like a county fair having to do with like heirlooms, growing food, lots of education. Actually, I do like that they kind of improved the education this year, which we'll talk about. Lots of cool vendors and booths every year. It cycles. There's different ones coming and going, but there's a lot of the common ones. Anyways, let's head inside and show you guys some of this year's Heirloom Expo.
To remind you guys that we're still doing Growing Your Greens t-shirt fundraiser. So if you want to support me and my work, you could definitely buy a Growing Your Greens t-shirt that directly supports me to allow me to continue to make my educational videos. Plus, you definitely get a really cool organic cotton Growing Your Greens t-shirt. So yeah, check the link down below, compassiontees.com. Link is also at the end of this video.
All right, so now we're headed into the main exhibit hall, and this is where most of the vendors are set up, although there's some outside vendors. I basically walked this hall like at least 3 times and found the best vendors to show you guys in this video because I do have limited time. Generally, I don't like to have the same vendor in year after year, so check my links down below for vendors that I have in previous years. This year will be mostly different. There's a few times where I'll put the same vendor in when they have some new products that I really want to share with you guys. So the first booth I want to show with you guys today is actually the SLOLA, and this is the Seed Library of Los Angeles. So if you guys live in Los Angeles, I have a video actually many years ago where I visited them down at the Venice High School property where they were running the library. But now they've expanded, so they have many different locations all around Los Angeles where you could pick up seeds. And I want to encourage you guys, I mean, this is the Heirloom Seed Expo. This is one of the booths you want to stop by because they're actually offering you guys free seeds. I always encourage you guys to join or find your local seed libraries because those seeds that the libraries have are always going to be the best for you guys to grow because they're probably regionally grown in many but not all cases. And if you guys want to find out where your local seed libraries are, you can check out a website. I think it's seedlibraries.net, and that's basically a directory so you guys can find a seed library near you. And if there isn't one, hey, start one. You know, we really need to preserve the genetic diversity out there, save our own seeds, trade seeds amongst each other, and more importantly, get connected. Anyways, let's go ahead and head on to some of the other cool exhibitors at this expo. All right, so now I'm gonna show the next booth. Either, you know, what I like about this event is that there's all kinds of different booths. You know, people that are here helping you grow food, people here that are selling you plants, people here that are selling you seeds, people that are here that are selling you appliances and things to process your food so you guys can get healthier, apps that you can help, you know, trade your crops. But this one's actually super important. It's actually called the Weedguard Plus, and this is 100% biodegradable paper weed block, and they have little samples here. And you know, instead of using plastic, you know, for mulch that could, when you cover your ground when you're growing tomatoes or something like that, right? If you put plastic down, you're growing tomatoes through, that's good because you're blocking the weeds. But the problem is when the sun hits the plastic, it can get really hot in there, like 140 degrees. This can negatively impact your beneficial microbes underneath the soil. And that's why the paper, you know, it's not gonna heat up that much. It's almost gonna be pretty much ambient temperature underneath this paper. The other thing about plastic is that we know plastic is nasty for the environment. You know, if it does break down, it'll break down into little pieces and put plastic into your soil. And if you guys are growing or certified organic, you guys can't be using the plastic because it'll break down. This is 100%, you know, approved for organic use because literally it's just paper is gonna break down. Now, the reason why this paper is different than like some kind of craft paper that you would go out and, you know, use like grocery bags or whatever and lay that down, that's because they're using different kinds of trees, hardwood and softwood, so that this is a lot stout. I mean, look at this. I could pull it apart and it's like pretty good. I mean, it could get wet, it could dry out. It's gonna be totally solid and last probably about a season. It probably won't last more than a season like that. But I think, you know, covering your soil is one of the most critical things you guys do, whether you want to use, you know, a fabric, you know, a paper fabric like this, or whether you want to do something like leaves or wood chips, you know, coconut chunks. I mean, each kind of these methods have their own pros and cons. But let me tell you guys, the reason why I stopped here today is because they have some, you know, testing that they've done at different nurseries. Let's see here. Oh, and like one of these is a picture that got sent into them. Look at this. Okay, this is with straw mulch, right? This farm was growing these, and with straw mulch, like, the plants don't really look that vibrant, they don't look as healthy, and just by simply trading out the straw mulch to the weed guard, look at the plants. They're like a lot more healthy, they're growing more lush, and they're gonna get basically improved yields. In addition, they have a lot of other, you know, testing they've done that shows, you know, some of the benefits of different nurseries on zucchinis and bell peppers. Here's a comparison between plastic mulch and the weed guard. I mean, look at the difference. Oh my God, you know, heating up the soil with the standard plastic, with the black plastic, absorbs the heat. It's going to kill your microbes, which is going to mean your plants are going to not absorb as much nutrients because the microbes aren't working to break down the organic matter to turn them into nutrients like the Weedguard Plus. So this is really cool stuff, you know. I think what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to get some of this stuff for testing and have an upcoming video on it. I'm going to use it maybe in the summertime and, you know, in the climate that I'm at, because it doesn't rain. I mean, it should last me the whole season, and I might even be getting a second season out of it because I'm bottom watering, not top watering. So I'm really looking forward to using the Weedguard Plus. If you want to learn more, you can check them out at weedguardplus.com. So if you guys have a productive garden because you guys follow what I say, right, you're going to have lots of food. And the problem is, how do you get this food into you instead of buying food from the grocery store, right? I want you guys to always eat out of your garden first before you buy things at the grocery store. But the problem is, most people don't know how to prepare all these, you know, fresh fruits and vegetables, and that's a huge problem, right? But with the Salad Master, they're gonna make it really easy for you guys to do, and they got this little tool right here, and let me show you guys how this works. I mean, it comes with different blades, and you can make different kinds of slices out of, like, radishes, beets, zucchini, more beets, and some carrots, and they have all these different blades, so you can make all different kinds of textures quickly and easily in your own kitchen. And look at this. Who doesn't want to eat this nice rainbow salad full of phytonutrients, antioxidants, vitamins and minerals, so you could actually disease-proof yourself, right? Instead of eating the processed foods that cause disease, in my opinion, based on my research and talking to a lot of people. Anyways, I want to show you guys actually how easy this Salad Master is to use. Check this out. I mean, this is fully hand-operated, so even if you're living off the grid, it doesn't matter. If you've got no power, if your power goes out, you're still preparing your own homemade plant-based foods at home. So you just take one of the zucchinis you guys grow in a garden. You guys know that zucchinis, they put out a lot of fruit during the season. You always have extra zucchinis. What can you do with it? Well, yeah, some people I ran into just the other day likes to grill their zucchinis. I actually don't like to grill my zucchinis. I think that's a waste of zucchini. You lose some of the valuable phytonutrients as well as some of the flavor. So literally you're just gonna take this device here. It has a nice suction cup, so it sticks down, and it's all stainless steel. I mean, this is made like it's made in the 1920s, but it's made today. You literally crank it with your hands, super simple. You take your zucchini, put it on here, and look at that. Look at that, man. We're cranking out the zucchini as fast as I could put it in there, right? Boom, we're gonna be through the whole zucchini in like less than 20 seconds. And it's totally done. Now you have instant shredded zucchini now, and all you need to do now is take your blender, throw in some fresh tomatoes, some sun-dried tomatoes, maybe a couple dates for sweetening, some Italian seasoning, and a little bit of miso for flavoring. Blend that up into a nice sauce, pour this all over your zucchini so you could eat a nice, fresh meal literally straight out of your garden so you guys can get the health benefits and also save money and eat higher quality food. So these items, this Salad Master is totally amazing, and here's the thing, right? If you guys are lucky enough to live in the San Francisco Bay Area, so you guys know if you guys live in the San Francisco Bay Area, the 510, the 925, you know, the 415, the 650, the 415, the 707, grow code, I mean, wherever you guys live, right? You guys can get one of these guys for free, right? You guys wanna learn how to get one of these for free? This is like a $500 value right here, this Salad Master, right? But I've hooked you guys up with Isis right here, right? You're gonna check out her website, saladmaster.info, right? If you guys live in the Bay Area and you wanna host a dinner party for six of your friends, you invite them over, Isis will come over with her Salad Master, show you guys how it works, where she's gonna talk to you guys about eating healthfully, how to eat healthier, and how the Salad Master could help you guys do that. And then the person that's putting on the event, right, gets one of these guys for free. So you guys could get one of these, and I want you guys to get this for free. It's $495 value. So 500, and this is heavy. This is not some cheap piece of Chinese stuff, man. This is nice heavy duty with all these nice blades that you gotta be careful because you can't cut yourself on. So if you guys wanna learn more how to get your own Salad Master and you're in the Bay Area, contact Isis at saladmaster.info and be sure to let her know that you saw her on John Kohler's show to get your free Salad Master. All right, so the next booth I want to show you guys is actually a repeat, and normally I don't do repeats in my videos because, you know, the time is so short. My video is already so long, people are going to complain anyways. But this is a company that I really like a lot. I use their products on a regular basis, and it's not cheap plastic. This is a product made in the United States in Oakland with American workers. And it's actually the self-watering seed pots by Orta. And these things are totally amazing. Let me show you guys actually how these work, right? So this is the original one is small, right? So when I saw her the first time, maybe like 5 years ago now, she had these and I'm like, well, these are nice, but they're not super functional for a gardener, right? Maybe it is for you guys, but for me, you could maybe grow 6 plants from seed, put in water, and they automatically germinate on their own without you do anything. And actually, because I travel so much, this is a perfect thing I like to use, but also the reservoir is smaller. So the water basically goes in here and it wicks through the ceramic to feed the soil. You gotta make sure you have a nice potting soil mix that's actually gonna wick it up and not just some kind of compost, right? So then what she did the next year, she came back and she's like, John, I got something for you. And she said, look what we did. We got the big version. So like, this is totally awesome. I have 2 of these that I start like my rare crops that like sometimes won't, you know, germinate outside. I'll put them in here. I'll leave them inside under some lights in my house. And then I fill this up with water and I don't have to worry about watering them if I'm traveling to wherever in the world I'm traveling to, right? This is taking care of it. It's doing the watering. And then when I come back from my trip a week later, I just fill this up. And then when I come back, you know, I have little starter plants and then I take a little, you know, a wire, stick it underneath there and pop them out. Then there's like a really nice root ball in here. They haven't really gotten wrapped around too much because it's just going in the ceramic and that's where the water comes out. So you can literally start like 12 plants inside this little container here. So this is really cool in itself. And you know, I've set up a special deal for you guys to get a special discount on the factory seconds, right? She has first, and if you want to have that perfect ceramic thing that's going to look nice and not have any blemishes, you guys can get the first, but they cost significantly more money. If you want to get the seconds like me, I'm kind of more economical, right? It might have a blemish or it's not perfect, but it fully holds water. It's fully functional. You can save a lot of money. So, I mean, it's cool that she has this. I mean, one of the cool things this year is you guys can see like what it looks like on the inside, right? On the inside, it basically, this holds a reservoir down here and the water just wicks up. So as long as the water is wicking, even if it's like so low, it still wicks up into the top. Of course, you want to try to have the water as full as possible when you're germinating your seed so it has the moist moisture in the top. Now, if that wasn't cool enough, the new thing they're doing, because you know they're kind of aware of what's going on in the market, they're now doing a kit for microgreens. One of the problems I have with growing microgreens is that I'm never home to water them, right? You gotta mist them every day, you gotta keep the soil, you know, moisture level just right, or it's not really gonna work. You have too much moisture, they're gonna mold. If you don't have enough moisture, they're not gonna sprout, right? Worry about that no more with the new Orta microgreens grower. So check it out. They came out with this version here, which I mean, I'll honestly tell you guys, don't waste your money. This is too small. If you're just gonna grow some for fun, this is like too small for me, so save your money. I'm sure she'll still sell a lot of these guys. Save your money. But what you guys want is you guys want this big one. This is at least like about twice the size of that small size that you guys just saw. This will grow a good amount of microgreens in one fall swoop without any work, right? And check it out. So literally this is the same design concept. You fill this up with water, you put your good potting soil medium in there, you put your seeds in there, you cover your seeds a little bit just like they would grow in nature, right? The water wicks through the ceramic, wets the soil, which then migrates into the soil, gets the soil just wet enough so that your microgreens grow and shoot out. And then, you know, after about 10 days, I'd put them on under lights inside the house. Don't put the microgreens outside the house. They like the temperature we like, right? It can't be too cold, can't be too hot, not in direct sun, that'll totally burn them. And then you're gonna have some microgreens. So they're growing some little micro brassicas here. And then here they got some wheatgrass. Now, the complaint I have about this is that they didn't seed this heavy enough, man. There's like, this is like too sparse. I'd put like a lot more seeds in there so you could get a lot more growth. And once again, I like this a lot because literally it's like a do-nothing garden. If you've never been successful at growing anything before, you got to get this, fill it up with some dirt, get some good viable seeds, put them in there, fill it up with water, and just set it down and come back and you're going to have some food really to grow. I mean, one of the biggest problems I see with new gardeners is they try to overwater stuff. Oh, I love my plants, I'm going to overwater. Then guess what? They drown. Like if you have too much water, you're going to drown. It's going to imbalance your electrolytes and all this kind of stuff, right? So totally amazing that Orta is, you know, making new products that allows you guys to grow food more easily. I do have some samples of these. They sent me like actually a month ago, but I've been traveling so much I haven't even even been time to open a box, but after seeing it, I'm so excited about it. I'm gonna hopefully have to open it up and try to make a video for you guys to see, you know, and show you guys what it's like. So in the meanwhile, if you guys wanna learn more about the Orta Kitchen Garden, get notified when they have some of the larger microgreens gardens available for you guys and get the special GYG discount, make sure you go to their website, ortakitchengarden.com, and make sure you use the coupon code GYG. You know, they have these 12 packs right now, but the microgreens ones are not quite available. So get on their email list and get notified when they're available. And the GYG code's good through the end of October. All right, the next booth I want to show you guys today is actually Johnny's Select Seeds, right? Aside from Baker Creek Heirloom Seeds, which I like a lot, right? I go to a lot of different seed companies because not one seed company will ever have all the seeds you need. And if you're thinking, wait a second, John, you're at the Heirloom Expo, but Johnny's, you know, they sell heirloom, but they also sell hybrid seeds. Hybrids are bad. No, no, no. Hybrids that are not genetically modified are not bad. They're just selected for certain traits, right? And I want you guys to get the traits that are important to you. Like some traits that are really important to me are high antioxidants. I want high antioxidant foods. And I don't care if those plants or those crops won't ship good, because I'm picking them and I'm eating them in my garden, right? The other thing that Johnny's has is, you know, they have select varieties that will do good in certain situations. So for example, the Salanova lettuce is a popular variety with many market gardeners out there and may also grow good for you guys at the home. So you guys literally have access, you home gardeners have access to some of the, you know, seeds that, you know, market gardeners and big farmers actually use and have great success from. So it's kind of like time proven. The other thing that I'll recommend for you guys while I'm at the Johnny's booth is this. Every year, Johnny's comes out with new AAS seeds. This is very important if you've never heard about this before, so listen up, guys. All American selections winners are basically seeds that have been trialed all around the country that have been proven to do good in many different areas of the United States of America. So if you've never been able to grow a certain kind of pepper or this, you want to try an AAS winner because they have a higher probability of chance of actually making it and growing well for you guys, you know. So this year, the 2008 winners are the Red Ember Cayenne Chili Pepper, the Valentine Grape Tomato. The previous winners are Corno de Toro's Peppers. And then actually one of the ones I grew actually out last year was the Carmen Sweet Pepper. And actually that was one of the best performing peppers last year in my garden, the Carmen. So yes, pay attention to the AAS selection winners. Try to pick a few of those out in your garden every year to grow. The other thing I like about Johnny's is their catalog. Oh my God, this is one of the nicest catalogs aside from Baker Creek catalogs. Full color, and they do more than just sell you the seeds. They have a lot of information, lots of different pictures on showing you guys what it's like. I really particularly like Johnny's for their microgreen selection, and they have pictures on what the microgreens actually look like when they sprout up. I don't know if I'll be able to find it super quick here. But yeah, request one of their catalogs. Great to look through, you know, through the winter time as you're selecting for new seeds for next season. Oh, and then finally, reason why I wanted to stop by here was I wanted to give you guys a special coupon code you guys wouldn't have gotten unless you're here. Hope they're not gonna get mad at me for doing that. It's basically $10 off $50 purchase or more using your offer code 19-3143, but it offer ends 12/31/18. So order your 2019 seeds about the middle of end of December before the code expires to get the good deal, so you're getting some good fresh seeds. All right, so the next booth I want to show you guys only really helps you guys out if you are here. It's not going to help you guys if you guys are watching this after the fact, but if you guys come to future Heirloom Expos, you want to always check out this booth. It's always in the front corner or one of the front ends of the expo hall here. And actually this is the School Garden Network of Sonoma County. Every year up to this year, they've had like an silent auction where you could actually bid on different you know, gardening paraphernalia and different things to help you guys garden more and actually save some money. So they have like the value of this, you know, whatever thing is $50 and you might be able to get it for 30 bucks. This year they're doing a little bit different actually. They're actually just straight up selling you guys things at a discount. So, you know, we're here on the last day, so this place has totally been picked over. All the good stuff's already gone. But nonetheless, they still have, you know, different photo albums and different things you guys could save, you know, significant money on. And all the proceeds go to help get, you know, school gardens put in Sonoma County. And the cool one of the statistics I heard, I think it's accurate, is that of the school gardens they put in, 85% of them are still operating today, educating children, you know, about growing food. So, I mean, school gardens is one of the most important things you guys could help out and invest in. So, you know, supporting an organization like this or other organizations like in your area to help kids learn about where food comes from, growing their food and preparing their food fresh so that they can start eating healthier. Because let me tell you something, if the upcoming generation does not start to eat healthier and become healthier, man, this world is really going to poop. All right, so the next booth I want to share with you guys, actually there's two apps that are pretty close together, and these are apps I think you guys should get. These guys could help you guys out a lot. Currently, this is a free app. This is actually a Grow Topo. They should have like a little tablet up on a little stand so people could kind of play and see what it is, but basically I'll explain it to you. So basically what Grow Topo is, and it's an app that you could download, and you're gonna download the app to your phone, and then basically you have these little tags, right? So these little plant tags you'll actually stick in, you know, right at your plant when you plant your seed or your seedling, right? You're then gonna, you know, scan this little barcode thing, and it's gonna take you to a web page that then you could talk about, hey, you know, this barcode is for the zucchini plant. You could take a picture when it started, and then you could, you know, keep basically a journal and a diary of all the things that have happened to it, when you've watered it, when you've taken care of it, when you've harvested it, any bugs or pest issues you've had over the season, and then at the end of the season you could kind of review what happened, and more importantly, the following year you guys could see actually what happened to it, so you could see, hey, you know, on this date I had problems with it, or on this date it froze, you know, so it kind of makes tracking your plants a lot easier. They're going to do a lot more like improvements to the app, I'm sure, in the future, but this is the basics, and you know, I definitely think it can't hurt because currently it's free. I mean, another thing that's really cool, if you want it, they don't have these at present time, but they're going to have like more permanent, you know, barcodes on like permanent stuff instead of these plastic ones that you could like maybe put on a whole bed, so you could even catalog all the different things in your bed. So it just really makes it a nice, easy way to track your plants year after year to see, you know, how you could adjust, how you could modify, maybe grow in a different variety the following year if one variety didn't do well, but you kept notes on it. Of course, you could also have a regular garden journal that if the internet goes down, it's still going to be functional. Oh, if you want to learn more about this, you can learn more about them at growtopo.com. I've had this before in previous episodes, but I want to cover it again, right? So this is Daniel with the Crop Swap app. So Daniel, real quick, what does the Crop Swap app do for those of you guys that haven't seen the video last year?
Really quickly, it's buy, selling, and trading of homegrown produce from your phone. So if you have somebody in your neighborhood and you have extra something, you can trade with somebody else and have homegrown stuff. If you don't have anything to trade, you can always use cash or even pay with work.
That's awesome, man. So basically, if you have a neighbor that has lemons and you don't have lemons, but you have a lot of tomatoes, you could trade with your neighbor to get the lemons for your tomatoes, right?
That's correct, absolutely. And we want to encourage biodiversity. We want neighbors to talk to one another, and we want people to eat healthier.
Cool, and if you don't even grow a garden, right, you could go on the Crop Swap app to try to buy some produce from local people, so that's the best. I mean, I think that's a marketing opportunity you're missing to like people at farmers markets that they could just source things locally. That's even probably better in some cases than farmers markets because they're next door neighbors, right?
Absolutely. Keep going.
I'm good. And then the other thing is, like, so, you know, previously this was only on the iPhone store on an iPhone, but guess what's the new stuff?
Yeah, we have a whole new, we have a whole series of versions, but Android is actually, we have a beta out right now, but it's going to be done in like a few days, and we have new stuff coming with the app. We're gonna add this whole functionality to donate to food banks. We want to just make it better. We're listening to farmers now. You know, farmers use the app differently than gardeners, so we're really listening to those of you. You can always write us and tell us what you like or don't like about the app. We want to make it good.
And this app is 100% free, guys. Yes. So go ahead and download it and get involved. Put your, you know, location on there. You could also put like your growing practices. So if you're concerned about the food you're eating, your family's eating, you could put that all on there. So it's like full transparency. This is like one of the best inventions in gardening today. You guys definitely got to download it. And more importantly, right, share it with other gardeners in your area so that more people can get on this app, because the more powerful this app is, right, the more people that are on it, the better it's going to be for everybody. We could all connect together and eat more local food and get away from the industrial agriculture system. So Daniel, if somebody wants to you know, download this and all this stuff, how do they do it?
So all you honestly do is, you know, go to cropswapapp.com and we'll have the links right there. And you know, and as John said, it's all about getting other people in your neighborhood. Somebody said something to me, it's, our app is like a fax machine. If you're the only person with a fax machine, it doesn't work. So it's all about telling other people in your neighborhood through next door or whatever. Tell your people, and that's how you do it. cropswapapp.com.
Awesome, man. Thanks, Daniel.
Yeah.
We'll catch you later, man. All right, so this next booth is kind of interesting, right? It doesn't necessarily have to do with growing stuff or processing the food you eat, But what it has to do with, it has to do about our environment, right? And the environment that we're living in affects the food that we're growing, right? Whether you believe in chemtrails or not, I don't really care, right? And that's up to debate. I'm not gonna get into that. But what I will say is that this organization here, it's swataluminum.org, right, has done testing around the state of California, right, at different areas to show in some areas like forests, right, aluminum levels are off the chart. Like, where is this aluminum coming from, right? Maybe it's chemtrails, if you guys believe in that. Maybe it's something else. Maybe it's already existing in the soil. I mean, I personally doubt that because they have other tests in water and stuff. The aluminum levels are quite low. So, I mean, basically this organization is here to basically force the state of California to start doing testing to recognize this. And when the state of California actually does the testing and sees these high levels, these are outside the EPA guidelines, and then something will have to be done. They're gonna have to figure out where the heck is this aluminum stuff coming from? How can we stop it, right? And so that's all I wanna say. You know, I want you guys to support this this mission here, swataluminum.org, and they should be doing this testing all over the country for not only aluminum, but other heavy metals that may be polluting our environment. And the reason why this is important for me and for you guys out there that are gardeners is because of this. You guys see that picture up there with the grass, right? The grass on the right is the one that actually has aluminum in the soil, and the grass on the left is one that doesn't have all the high levels of aluminum, right? High levels of aluminum will restrict plant growth. It's definitely not good. So we should all be concerned about our environment and try to help improve it. So once again, visit the website, swataluminum.org, learn from them, and even start a chapter in your area, you know, to help create awareness about this aluminum, a potential aluminum problem that's occurring. All right, thank you. All right. All right, so now we're finally out of the building, and I want to show you guys some outside vendors, right? As much as you guys come in and walk the aisles inside, always come outside. Some of the coolest vendors happen to be actually outside this year. Some of my favorite ones, and actually this one you guys are gonna like a lot, and I'm glad you guys stayed to watch this part, because this company will send you a free sample. Like I asked them like three times, will you send like 1,000 people free samples? And they said yes. So they're gonna pay the shipping too, right? So anyways, I want to share with you guys what this is. This is actually the amazing Dr. Zymes. If you guys watched me on my pod, on my live stream recently, I talked about this. I talked about this in passing in a few videos. I haven't had a specific video on this product yet because I'm still in my testing phase. So I'm gonna tell you guys that, right? So what I wanna tell you guys about the Dr. Zymes product is this. This is probably my favorite insecticide and fungicide product, like, in the world. You're like thinking, John, wait, I saw your video that you did with Josh on the neem oil and Dr. Bronner's. I thought that was your favorite. Well, times have changed. I've learned about new products that are even less persistent in the environment, that are gonna harm the environment less, and even on some things, even more effective, which is totally insane and crazy, right? It sounds like the best of both worlds. This sounds like a dream product. I'm still testing to see if it could kind of work, because the first time I didn't get enough samples to try to get a full evaluation, but it seemed to work, but I'm not exactly sure. So, you know, keep that in mind before you start buying all this stuff, but they will send you a free sample that I'll tell you guys in just a minute. So what this product is, this is actually called the Amazing Dr. Zymes. And what it is, how it's explained to me, is that this is basically an enzyme-based product. And basically when you spray it on, the bugs, basically it melts them. It's like it melts their exoskeleton because it's some kind of enzymes like chitinase or something that literally will melt them. It's kind of like if we took hydrochloric acid or whatever and poured it on us and our skin dissolved, right? That's what you're doing to the bugs. And here's the cool part, right? Enzymes are only active, number one, in certain temperature ranges. So if it's too cold or too hot, the enzymes ain't gonna work. So don't be spraying this stuff in direct sun. You gotta actually do it. I like to do it late in the evening, right before the sun goes down, so there's no direct sun contact on it. And number two, when the water or the carrier inside here disappears, the enzymes are no longer active. So what does this mean? You're like thinking, John, that sucks, man. That sucks because as soon as it disappears, it's gone. It can't kill any bugs anymore. Well, you might think that, but actually on the flip side, actually, I think that's probably one of the best features of this, because now you know you're not gonna harm your beneficial insects, your pollinator insects, because once this evaporates, it's totally gone. It's not persistent like neem oil and other oil products are gonna hang out in your environment for a while. So on the side here, it says insecticide and fungicide, and it's kills and eliminates insects, including larvae and eggs. Take a keyword there, eggs, of aphids, fungus gnats, mites, root aphids, thrips, whiteflies, fungus, molds, and mildew. totally amazing, right? And the thing I like about this is, you know, a lot of you guys that grow medicinal herbs or even just home gardeners have spider mite issues, right? The reason why I like this is because I was told, and I haven't proven this yet, I don't have enough of the product yet, is, you know, it'll kill the mites on contact, but also, unlike, you know, a neem oil that won't really affect the eggs because it can't really get through there, it's, you need to kind of spray it on the spider mites, this actually will kill the eggs too. So that's totally amazing. So I want you guys to, you know, take them up on the offer and get your little sample bottle, which is about like this. So this sample bottle you basically put into like 1 quart of water. I just put it in a spray bottle and just spray it on the leaves of aphids, where there's aphids and whiteflies, all the insects they say, and to see if it makes a difference. And leave your comments and posts down below this video once you try it to let me know. I'll take a look, I'll try to come back and take a look to see if you guys are getting good results. That'll just help me determine if I want to make a dedicated episode to promoting this product or not. I mean, it sounds like it's amazing. I hope it works as well as they say. You know, there are a lot of testimonials from people that have been using this, like say in the cannabis industry. This is also OMRI certified organic. So if you guys want to get the special deal about this, and learn more about the product, check out drzymes.com. That's drzymes. And you want to email Genevieve at drzymes.com. So check the link down below in the description for Genevieve's exact spelling of her name. And just give her, say, hey, I saw you on John Kohler, and you know, send me out my free sample. And she said she'll do it. All right, so this next booth, not necessarily having to do with something to help you guys grow food or process your food like some of the other booths, but this is actually my favorite booth that has something super like medicinal that you guys should be taking that's been used as a medicine in many countries around the world. This is BLA Farms from Punta Arenas, Costa Rica, right?
Pura Vida, John.
Pura Vida, yeah, this is the owner right here. And basically she's the owner of the farm, and she makes sure that you guys are gonna get the highest quality, most nutrient dense turmeric on the entire planet, grown with permaculture principles. They're working on growing the soil, not growing the turmeric. And this is the turmeric right here. And let me tell you guys, I've bought a lot of turmeric in my times. And we're gonna go ahead and open this guy up right here, right? We're gonna open this guy up and look at that nice, rich, dark color. A lot of the turmerics you guys will buy will be like off color, a little bit oxidized. This is nice, bright, you know, orange color. And when I stick my nose in here, you really get a nice whiff. I mean, literally it smells like you're grating up turmeric in your kitchen from turmeric you grow, or, you know, if you just go to the store and buy it. I mean, this is the freshest stuff that I ever found, right? The other thing they do is, you know, they're trying to regenerate the land and grow in a sustainable way, and they have only limited production, right? So they only sell it in this size, but guess what? This size will last you all year. You know, I've heard testimonials from people that have used turmeric in the past and gotten rid of their inflammation, and it's helped their health out so much. This is one of the most important root vegetables you guys could be eating, and if you guys don't grow it, then you guys should definitely be including it in different recipes, you know, each and every day. So this is one of the highest quality ones I've seen. Now, aside from that, they also have different kinds of teas, you know, including, let's see, this guy right here.
Raviola.
Oh, the soursop leaves. So the soursop leaves, if you guys do a Google search on soursop and cancer, you guys are probably gonna find a lot of stuff on how soursop leaves, you know, may help people with cancer and all this kind of stuff. I'm not gonna get into details on that. Do your own searches. But what I will say is they have some really nice quality dried soursop leaves, as well as graviola, papaya leaves for tea and other teas, right? So yeah, one of my favorite companies. I talked to them in detail to kind of like learn their farming practices and how they're doing it. Definitely some good stuff here. If you guys want to learn more, you want to check them out at timelessturmeric.com. And I set up a special discount code for you guys too. So use the code GYG for actually $10 off your bag of turmeric. So you're gonna get the highest quality turmeric at the lowest price. All right, so this is not gonna necessarily interest you, a lot of you guys, but a lot of you guys that are farmers or market gardeners that actually have a tractor, I mean, I gotta show you guys this because this is super cool. The first time I've ever seen one of these in my life. This is actually called the Select Track. And what this is a solar powered, or not solar powered, but electricity powered tractor. So think how a Tesla is to like a Porsche and can blow it away and has more torque and all this stuff, right? This the electric tractor with batteries, you know, has more torque at low RPMs or right off the line than even, you know, a diesel tractor. They tend to work, you know, at a higher RPM. But you got all the standard hookups on the back here. This is actually modeled after, they use parts from like an old school Ford tractor, so it's really easy to get parts on this. They basically just modified it to work on electricity. And of course, if you get solar panels, then you could charge your electric tractor with the solar panels, so that's really cool. All right, so I'm not gonna really get into the details. I'm gonna drive the tractor in and show you guys all the cool stuff, but I don't really know about tractors. Maybe when I have some property, I'll actually get one of these guys. These guys actually are probably about double the price of a standard diesel tractor, but your footprint's gonna be a lot less, and I want you guys to consider the environment. You know, if you guys are running a diesel tractor now, right, when you guys are exhausting your diesel fumes onto your crops, maybe your crops aren't organic anymore, right? So these are things that we don't really think about, but if you wanna do like the best job for the environment, for nature, for your health, because you're also breathing the diesel fumes, which are really bad actually, you guys want to go like you know, electric for your tractor. So selecttrac.com to learn more. They're currently in limited production. I hope this company survives and succeeds and sells lots of electric tractors to make a good change in the world. All right, so the next booth I want to show you guys is actually the Exotica booth, and unfortunately, you know, I've been so busy this event, meeting all you viewers that have been coming up to me. I try to stop and talk to everybody, but sometimes I'm just super busy because I got like all these different talks and lectures, and I'm trying to film a video for all you guys out there watching me. I don't get to film until the last day, which I was like, John, you got to film on the first day because all the displays look better. There's a bigger selection of plants, but I'll tell that to you guys. And you know, I ran into a few people that said, John, I took your advice. I came on the first day so they could get the best plants, right? And on the first day, actually, I scoured up two plant starts, you know, little starter plants that I've never seen before in my life. They're actually known as Livingston potatoes. So that's really cool. So yeah, if you want to get some good plants and stuff, come here on the first day so you don't get like, it doesn't look like this, which is basically, you know, it's pretty wasted. They also had a nice, really nice fruit display the first day, but by now it's all been eaten. So let me show you guys what's left of the fruit display and some of the sparse trees that they have left. I think the one tree I really want to talk about was the chay tree, which I've had once before. Oh, and this looks still pretty nice, although they had a lot more. They have, you know, all these different tropical fruits and things that you could potentially grow depending on what part of California. Of course, some are just tropicals that you can't grow here. All right, so lots of seasonal fruits right now. I got to try one of these key apples for the first time. Of course, one of my favorite crops you guys should grow are the jujubes. There's different kinds, the Lee jujube. I think they could probably got a Lang. They got, you know, tamarinds, long ends. Some of these bananas you could grow in Southern California. Some of the stuff you could grow here and some of the stuff you can't. But yeah, always, I had my first California lychee. This was actually grown in California right here. Just because you're in California, I don't think you can't grow a lychee, but you gotta live in San Diego. So yeah, I love Exotica Fruit Tree Nursery. Be sure to check the link down below for actually a tour when I went to Exotica and visited them to give you guys a tour of their nursery down there in Vista, California. All right, so the last vendor booth I want to show you guys actually is Southern Sun Farm here. They're located outside, and their table on the last day doesn't really look like much, right? On the first day, it was amazing. They had all these pots of all these cool different exotic cactuses. Some even had these little fruits that looked like blueberries, which are totally amazing. In addition, this is where I got the rare, you know, potato, the Livingston potato that's in the mint family. So it's kind of like related to Crohn's or Chinese artichoke. Have you guys heard of that? So I've never seen this or heard of it in my life. So I picked up some plants here. Unfortunately, they got damaged, and it was my fault, evidently, because I put them somewhere where I shouldn't, and somebody ended up breaking them, and then I was blamed for the breakage of my plants because I put them in the wrong place, which that wasn't too cool, in my opinion. But anyways, this guy has some super rare stuff. He's located in Escondido, California. Look him up online, contact him. He'll be probably here next year, maybe, hopefully. But I'm gonna be getting down to his farm, trust me, because he has a lot of cool, rare stuff that you really haven't seen anywhere else. So I'll probably be having an upcoming episode there at the farm. All right, so that was all the vendors now, and what I wanna do with you guys now is actually we're gonna take you guys around the fairgrounds and show you guys some of the different areas of the event. All right, so now what I wanna do is actually take you guys into the Hall of Flowers, and this is actually the main display area with all the different heirlooms on display. Every year they have like a big pile of squash. So every year at the Heirloom Expo, they have like a big pile of squash, which is really cool. And like so many people take their picture in front of it. I'm guilty. I took an Instagram picture in front of you the other day. Make sure you check the link down below for my Instagram. Follow me on Instagram if you guys aren't already. Growing your greens. I always try to post something at least every day. I think they should do like next year, maybe like watermelons or something else, man. It's always squash. It gets kind of so boring after 8 years, right? I mean, and the thing is this, like I'm gonna tell you guys, like there's actually like bales in there and they're stacked up, so it's not like all deep with like pumpkins, right? Don't wanna ruin it for you guys. Nonetheless, still cool. Anyways, inside here you guys can see like people are still inside here and there's just so many different heirloom fruits and vegetables, you know. I've had videos where I actually go through some of the different ones. I'll post links down below to my previous Heirloom Expo videos. I'm not really gonna go into like all the different varieties. Every year it changes a bit depending on what the growers grow or not. I mean, this year they have like eggplants, lots of different melons, sweet melons, watermelons, hot peppers, and every year they have tons of squash. This is basically all the eggplant from Middle East and South America. I think what I want to do for you guys actually is show you guys some new heirlooms that they actually don't normally have. Like actually this year they have beets and carrots. All right, so I just got to share this with you guys, like all the different watermelons. Look at these watermelons. This is called the Carolina Cross. This guy could get up to 200 pounds. I'm probably not supposed to even pick this up here. Like this is like, look, I'm curling it. Like this is super heavy. You guys can get these seeds from Baker Creek Heirloom Seeds. Like they grow up to 200 pounds. That's like super insane. But the question I have, bigger is not always better. You're like, wait a second, John. But anyways, bigger's not always better. You know, I wonder how like really sweet these guys are. Now, if you're lucky enough to come to the Heirloom Expo, they were selling outside watermelons, but at the end of the expo, they generally sell all the ones inside. So if you wanna come here for the fruit, come here on the last day. But more importantly, if you wanna come here for the plants, the new genetic, the rare genetic varieties, come on the first day. let's see, so this year is really cool. You know, as much as I love all the fruits that they've been growing for year after year, this is the first year they really have a significant quantity of different kinds of root vegetables. You know, as much as I love watermelons, and they'll store for a period of time, right? You can't be storing watermelons through the winter. However, you can be growing your carrots through the winter, even if it snows where you are, because you plant your carrots, you know, about maybe 60 to 90 days, depending on the variety of carrot, before the last frost date, and you basically just mulch them heavy. They'll stay alive in the ground. They'll actually get a little bit sweeter, so you could go up and move back the snow, move back the mulch, and pull carrots up in the wintertime. So they're an awesome storage root crop that you can literally leave in the ground. If you don't harvest them, that's all right. They're just gonna grow the following year, go to flower, set seed, and save some of your own seeds. And of course, all the carrots here are heirlooms, which means you could save your seeds and you'll get the same exact variety year after year. So I mean, we're just gonna go down the line for you guys, show you guys some of these. So you guys can see they got like yellow carrots and they got lots of different kinds of orange carrots. Here's a cool carrot, it's called the Gniff carrot. It's like purple on the outside, but really white on the inside. I like that it's purple on the outside, but really it's white on the inside. So I wanna show you guys the kind of carrot that I want you guys to grow, which is this guy. Oh my God, look at this, man. People are like stealing these carrots. There's none of these carrots left. They're just all been cut up into pieces. And they're totally gone, so sad. These are the most valuable carrots on the whole table. This is known as a black nebula, and that's because it's purple through and through. If it has purple in the carrot, that means it has anthocyanins. Anthocyanins are very powerful phytochemicals that in animal studies have basically reversed things like heart disease and diabetes, all this kind of stuff, even when the rodents were eating junk food. So I'm not telling you guys this so that you guys will eat the carrots or drink the purple carrot juice like in a study and eat junk food. You guys can just get the, eat the purple carrots, grow the purple carrots, eat them or juice them and don't eat the junk food so you guys can be even healthier. And here's a nice example here. They got a lot of different colors and I love all different colors of foods. We wanna get all kinds, but I really try to focus on the purple these days. Here's a cosmic purple. So the cosmic purple, although they're purple on the outside, the inside they're still nice and orange. So yeah, definitely choose the seeds wisely, because you know, growing a purple one instead of a yellow one can yield you maybe at least 4 or 5, maybe up to 10 times more antioxidants and, you know, disease lessening nutrients. And here's another one, purple dragon, another cool purple one. This one looks cool from the outside, but once again, look, you cut it up on the inside. It's still really light on the inside. Oh, and this one's really cool. Atomic red, which is actually red through and through. But aside from red carrots, I prefer to get some beets. So let's take a look at the other side of the table where they have all these amazing beets. All right, so now I want to talk to you guys actually about beets. Beets are a superfood in their own right. I want you guys to grow your carrots, especially purple ones. You can eat the carrot roots, but you could also eat the carrot tops. Many people don't know that. As well as the beets. You could grow your beets, eat the roots, which store really well in the fridge. I've stored them successfully at least for like 2 months without issues with the tops cut off, very important, and stored at the right temperature. But also the beet tops are quite nutritious. They're like related to spinach, you know, really close to Swiss chard actually. They do have some oxalic acid in there. So you may be you know, weary of that if you're trying to really get some certain minerals from the beet tops. That may not be happening. What I like to do the most with beets is actually to juice them. You know, they can be pretty hard. I don't like necessarily the flavor when they're raw, but when I put them in the juice, it really concentrates the nice pigments in there. They did do you know, studies with athletes drinking beet juice, and it improved their performance. You know, and I want you all, these guys, to pick the darkest color beets. So like, you know, these guys are actually called Crosby's Egyptian beets. And actually these ones are really cool. These are called albino beets. And look at the difference between that, right? Tell me which one has more phytonutrients, the deep red one or the white one? Of course, the red one. Are you never gonna grow the white one? Hey, if you got tons of acreage, hey, grow some of these for fun. But you know, I try to focus on more phytonutrient rich foods when I have limited amount of space to grow my food in my backyard. So one of the reasons why I like the Heirloom Expo is because there's so many different varieties on display that I haven't really seen before. I really love this pepper display. I mean, it's really comprehensive actually. And it's multilingual, so it's in like a Spanish, in English, you know, one on each side. And there's different kinds of capsiums, and we're going to go down the line for you to some of the different kinds. I mean, some, probably most of these guys are hot. Some of them may not be so hot. I really like this, the peach ghost jammy. But you know, there's so many different varieties of peppers as well as other fruits and vegetables out there, and we're losing some of the diversity. You know, some of these may be crosses, some of them may be more wild types. But, you know, I want to encourage you guys to grow different kinds of peppers in your garden. Does this get you hungry, or does it make you want some hot sauce? All right. Anyways, we're going to check out the California Rare Fruit Growers next, which is right there. I'm not going to do a full booth, like, go over like I did 1 year. So once again, check the links down below for previous episodes. I did do the California Rare Fruit Growers episode, like, really good 1 year. This year, we're just going to kind of breeze by. I really like the California Rare Fruit Growers. I want to encourage you guys, if you guys live in California into growing fruits, check them out, crfg.org. And you guys could join your local chamber, especially in the springtime. You could get scion wood or for cuttings to do, you know, grafting, or some of the things like figs and mulberries. You could just stick the sticks in the ground and they'll actually grow roots. And then you could have all kinds of different produce like they have out here, from black walnuts, all different kinds of grapes, a goy peach, different kinds of peaches, melons, avocados, citrus, figs, and even more. So usually when you guys think heirloom, you think heirloom tomatoes, because those are the ones that are most widely available. Like if you go to the grocery store, you're gonna find heirloom tomatoes, and the Heirloom Expo does not disappoint with heirloom tomatoes. They have several different displays of people who grew out and are displaying many different types of heirloom tomatoes here. Some of them are really huge, some of them are smaller, some of them are different colors. I just think it's really amazing, you know, and I think that whatever kind of like variety or heirloom or even like hybrid turns you on, grow it and see what happens. Because the trick is, every different tomato plant will perform better or worse depending on the climate it's being grown in. Your climate may be good for this one or maybe good for that one, and you'll never know unless you experiment. All right, so now you guys can see on both sides of me are basically all kinds of heirloom fruits. Really cool. This side we have lots of different peppers, like all really nice displays with their names. This is the miniature chocolate bells. Really nice. I want to encourage you guys, you know, if you haven't had luck growing the big fat bell peppers, grow some miniature or smaller peppers. That's what I do in the heat of the desert. It works a lot better. I get a lot more larger quantities of fruit. Even though they're smaller, that's fine. Once again, here's all kinds of different heirloom tomatoes on these tables. And over here, this is really fun, man. Would you like a watermelon cake? Look at that. Just layers of watermelon stacked up just like a cake. And let me tell you guys, watermelon is a lot healthier for you guys than cake, all right? Here we're getting into some of the winter squashes here. I want you guys to grow winter squashes. They're excellent storage food, so you guys can eat from your garden in the winter, even if it snows where you are, because these guys are already in your, you know, cool garage to store. And many of them will store really well. Of course, some of them will store better than others, and by no means am I any kind of squash expert. But they are quite nutrient dense, and I want to encourage you guys to pick squashes that are deep, rich colored on the inside. All right, now I want to show you guys actually the garden courtyard area. And this is normally the area where they have a sign that says like the Demeter's biodynamic garden area. This year they didn't put it up, and actually I'm glad they didn't put it up because the last couple years they've been doing it, it hasn't actually looked that good. If you want to see a good example of what it looked like in the past, in the olden days, check the link down below. I have an excellent video explaining more about the biodynamics. This year, you know, they have actually Malibu compost. So let's go inside and learn a little bit more about Malibu compost. So this year I took some time to learn more about the Malibu compost. And after speaking with one of the co-founders of Malibu compost, I'm gonna say that if you do wanna use some kind of manure product, this is the only one I would recommend because they go through special procedures to ensure that they're basically pathogen free, you know, contaminant free and don't have any kind of bad E. coli's or all this kind of stuff in there. Most cow manures may be contaminated with antibiotics and all these other crazy things. In addition, most manure products are actually not even composted, which might be very deadly to use. Like literally, that's why they have the outbreaks on spinach and cantaloupes, not because the spinach and cantaloupes are bad, because there's some cow manure that got infected that then infected and was living on the vegetables and the fruits. So anyways, what I'm gonna do is actually in the upcoming episodes, so make sure you click that link, you know, subscribe button down below, click the bell so you get notified. I'll be interviewing one of the owners of Malibu Compost so you guys can learn more about, is cow manure good or bad? All right, so there's about three different areas where there's different presentations going on, and this is the first year they've done this, the round table hall, which actually I like a lot. Let's come in, it's a little bit dark in here. But basically what's going on in here, there's a sign and there's four tables set up, and at each one of the tables every hour there's a different speaker or presenter talking on various different topics, whether that's goats, soap making, Asian vegetables, hugel culture, raised bed gardening, all kinds of stuff. And it's like actually a small group format, so actually you're gonna learn a lot better. I mean, there's somebody behind me over there, and there's like five people at the table, so they're really getting like almost one-on-one knowledge from the expert who is speaking. So I really like that they're doing this, because now they could actually even have more presentations and share more knowledge and spread the information about gardening and growing your own food. All right, so one of the next buildings, and this has been a major building because I've seen a lot of school buses coming. I think that's one of the real big powers of the Heirloom Expo, is to educate kids and, more importantly, get them excited about food and real food, where food comes from, growing heirlooms, all this kind of stuff, and all the education that goes on and the events and activities and tastings they have inside the kids pavilion. So I'm gonna take you guys inside there, show you guys really quick, you know, some of the exhibits and things I like a lot. All right, so in here they have all kinds of different activities for kids. In addition, they have free seed packets. So even if you're an adult, come to the kids pavilion because you could grab a free packet of seeds that you might not normally knew about. They also have, you know, different kinds of projects of deshelling beans, saving seeds for kids, and looking at seeds under microscopes. They have different areas about like worms and learning more about the worms there. Things are starting to break down because we're getting kind of to the end, and actually I got to take off really soon. But here's the main area of this exhibit hall, where they have all these displays from local schools that have shown like their gardening, what they're doing, how they're teaching, how they educate other kids, you know, growing food and different projects. In addition, on this side, oh yeah, they're still here. This place is really cool. So this is one of my favorite booths in the kids area. This is actually the Pollinator Posse from Oakland, California. And what they're doing is they're actually helping kids and teaching kids about pollinators. And how they're doing that is that they're making Airbnbs. That's A-I-R-B-B-E-E and B, because they basically get one of these small little birdhouses, and then they take these straws, paper straws, they cut them in half and they put them in here. So now this is gonna be a nice nest for pollinator bees, you know, not the, you know, or native bees, not the European honeybees. And that's really cool. Kids get to design and draw whatever they want on there. And that's a totally free. So if you got kids, one of the best places you guys could take your kids all year, and I told my brother to bring his kid, but didn't, is the Heirloom Expo to, you know, educate your kids more, because this education is not, for the most part, going on in the public schools about pollinators, bees, gardening and growing food. They got a lot of other different projects they got going on here as well. Also, they had little projects for kids, like the kids could paint their own little mask, and I'm gonna wear one right now. I'm a hummingbird. All right, so anyways, just having some fun. But anyways, so they were making bee condos actually for the bees, and you know, there's over 1,600 types of bees that are native to California, more than just the honeybees, and actually the native bees pollinate even more and more efficiently than the honeybees, so you definitely wanna have some kind of bee house, you know, bee hotel, for the native bees. And I'll let you guys know that I saw recently at Sam's Club and Costco, they're basically putting their bee hotels, because both of them sold native bee houses, on clearance for like $5, down from like $30. So I picked up mine a couple weeks ago. I don't know if you guys will still be able to find those. Anyways, if you guys want to learn more about the Pollinator Posse, check them out at pollinatorposse.org. Lots of information for you and your kids. All right, so one of the best days to come to the Heirloom Expo is actually the last day, which happens to be Thursday today. That's because they have the seed swap. So you can bring your seeds, swap your seeds, but also many different companies will donate their seeds. So literally, this is just a seed free-for-all. You can come and pick up a couple packs of seeds here, all different kinds of seeds, whether packets or different seeds that you just have to package up yourself. Lots of rare varieties that you're not gonna find anywhere else. So one of the cool things they've done this year that I actually haven't done in previous years is actually they created a squash Lambreth and a melon or watermelon Lambreth. So this is actually, the kids love this area because it's like one of those mazes you could walk through, whether you're an adult or a kid or a big kid, you just walk through the Lambreth and just kind of relax in a nice grassy field and walk through the huge giant watermelons that are probably at the end that will be selling for $5. Oh, and the other thing I want to say actually about the Heirloom Expo is this is entirely non-profit, so nobody's really making any money from this. All the money taken in from the gate sales after whatever they had to take whatever out to pay all the bills goes to non-profits to help educate kids about gardening and putting gardens in schools. So I think that's a worthy cause. All right, so there's a few, aside from the roundtable discussions, they're also having this, which is kind of new. Basically every hour or every half hour on the hour, they're doing a panel discussion. I was actually scheduled for 3 panels, but one of them was overlapping with my talk, so I really did 2 panels. It was quite fun, where we take audience questions and you learn about the topic at hand. So I talked on a plant-based panel where we talked about eating more fruits and vegetables and other plant foods. I also talked on a panel about growing in extreme conditions. So, they have a variety of panels, like all different kinds, so you guys could learn a lot. And I like that you get, more opinions than just the person. You get 3 different opinions, 3 people that have, experience with that topic, because you'll learn there's a lot of differences. But then what you want to look for, if you guys come to this so you don't get confused, is look for the similarities between all the different presenters. So last area I want to show you guys in here is actually just the main speaker hall. You guys could see the speaker up there, and a lot of them have slideshows. I just got up and spoke. Actually, if you want to see my presentation at the Heirloom Expo, click the subscribe button right down below. Make sure you hit the bell so you get notified when my talk comes out, which might be within the next few episodes here. But this room is huge, and this is the guy I interviewed actually. He's talking about how to grow with no money. So yeah, click subscribe so you guys could get the video with him, so you guys could grow with no money actually. So one of the cool things they're doing this year at the Heirloom Expo is that actually during the whole expo, starting from the first day, which was obviously the best day to come for selection of heirloom watermelons. This is the first time they did this. Normally they only sell the watermelons actually at the end. This time they had so many excess for some reason, they're selling all these heirloom seeded watermelons for $5. So better than buying a pack of seeds inside, you guys, buy some watermelon, get to enjoy the sweet, delicious watermelon, and then save your seeds on these guys. And look at this. I mean, so many people ask me, John, where do I get seeded watermelon, right? The best place at the Heirloom Expo, because literally they had these crates and crates and pallets of all these seeded watermelons, many different types. And the cool thing many people don't know is that you want to buy a couple of these, right? Watermelons will store, if they're in a good, condition off the vine easily for several weeks in your house. If you put them in the fridge, they're going to store even longer. All different kinds. And if you want to learn how to pick a good watermelon, make sure you click the link down below in the description, because I have a video that actually I made here a year or two ago on how to pick the best watermelons. It's kind of a long video, but I go over all the tips so you guys could pick the best one the first time. All right, so that's pretty much it for this Heirloom Expo 8th annual.
John, I watched your videos, man.
Oh, dude.
How are you doing?
Cool, and that's actually one of the reasons why I love this event so much, is because I get to meet so many fans and people that are, that follow me, watch me, and hopefully meet new ones that haven't followed me, and they can watch me too. I mean, we all need to connect together as a community to teach each other how to grow food. So what's up, man? I'm John. What's your name?
My name's Enoch Graham. I'm with the Urban Gardener on YouTube.
Oh, cool. You have a YouTube channel, man. Where are you from?
I'm from Southern Oregon.
Cool, so you grow in Southern Oregon. Like, what's your favorite heirloom to grow?
My favorite heirloom to grow, well, I really have a really good heirloom tomato, a really awesome cherry tomato.
And it does good in Southern Oregon, where that's cooler,
awesome.
Right?
Awesome, it does
What
awesome.
Variety? Everybody wants to know.
It's called a Praxis cherry tomato. It was developed and grown by another YouTube gardener.
Oh, Praxis.
Yes.
55712.
55712, Ray Browning.
Yeah, what's up, Ray? Cool, that does good for you in Oregon.
Oh, it does excellent. It's a really sweet, really delicious, really plump cherry tomato. Really, really love that one, man. It's
cool.
Great. It's really great. And it's awesome for growing in containers because that's what I do. I like growing in containers, small space gardening, and all that sort of stuff. We try to find anywhere we can grow in any type of place or home that you might have.
Oh my God, I got to come up to your place and make a video. Can I make a video of your place one of these days?
Absolutely. I would love to have you at my place and check out some of the cool things we do. We even take up space in our alleyway and all of that. We literally just try to take anything that isn't being used and any space being used and try to grow some food out of it. So we're growing right along alleyways, in my alleyways. We're working on some neighbors and some other places that are doing that. I also really like to grow peppers too, because did a pepper video, which was awesome.
Yeah.
I'm really glad about that. But I do them right up on a rooftop, on a carport.
Oh, wow.
So utilizing whatever kind of space you can grow in, because growing food is so, so important.
Awesome, man. And he's like not even growing in a yard. He's growing in pots on top of a carport roof, man. You guys can grow anywhere. So, hey, if somebody wants to see some of your videos, learn about you and your teachings, like, how can they learn more?
I am at youtube.com/c/theurbangardener and on Facebook at theurbangardener17.
All right, cool, man. I got to finish up my video, but it's great meeting you, man.
So
thanks
nice
so much.
Nice to meet you. Sorry for interrupting your video.
Yeah, no worries, dude. All right, so anyways, that's pretty much it for the 8th annual Heirloom Expo. I've had a great time meeting so many people and just trying to make a video is a bit hard when I'm getting distracted and people are saying, John, what's up? And all this kind of stuff. But I just love it. I mean, that's probably the biggest thing here, aside from all the heirlooms and the things you get to see, is just meeting other people that are into the same thing that you're into. I mean, that's priceless because, you know, not many people are really doing this yet. Hopefully it's growing. Hopefully you guys will start your own YouTube channel. You know, the more, the merrier. You know, everybody will gravitate to a different person and learn things from different people. So yeah, anyways, if you guys enjoyed this episode at the 8th annual Heirloom Expo, hey, please be sure to give me a thumbs up, right? This will encourage me to come back and make a video next year. You know, every year I come and I'm doing all kinds of different directions. You know, I'm filming interviews with different people that are gonna be upcoming. I'm trying to make this video. I need to give my talks, my lectures. I need to sit down and actually take care of myself, drink fluids and eat healthy. That's super important, which actually I'm gonna go ahead and eat some jackfruit right after this. But yeah, if you guys like this stuff, like this format, want me to do more, hey, thumbs up, that'll help me out as well. Also, be sure to share this video with somebody else that may not know about heirlooms that could learn a lot from this episode. I really love some of the vendors this year that I got to meet and learn more about, especially the Dr. Zines. And don't forget, right? Email whatever the person's name down below. I forget her name now, but email her for your free Dr. Zime sample. Makes 32 ounces once you add water to it. And I would only add like some kind of RO, reverse osmosis, or distilled water, some pure water without any kind of bacteria or chlorine or anything, because that might mess it up, right? Let me know how it works. Put your comments and links down below. And I asked her like 3 times. I'm like, you're gonna have thousands of people emailing you, and maybe she's only shipping in the US. So sorry, you guys outside the US. I don't know if she doesn't ship there for you guys. But yeah, so request that. I want to see how that product does and hear from you guys too, because I'm doing my own tests, all right? Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on any of my new and upcoming episodes of Command of Every 3 to 4 days. You never know where I'll ship or what we'll be learning on my YouTube channel. And be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge, over 1,400 episodes at this time. Teach you guys all aspects on how you guys can grow your own food at home. So with that, my name is John Kohler and the Super Giant Pumpkin by Ruben Frias. You won 1,491 pounds at the Heirloom Expo. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.